What's up, everybody? Welcome to another edition of the TT Podcast, episode number 18. Today, I am joined by Prince.
Hey there.
And Ace.
Hello.
Regular crew again today. So, a little more housekeeping. Again, volunteers, interviews. We just put one up. If you like it, you want to partake, please volunteer. And then Extra Life is technically over, but it's not technically over. So the big marathon day just passed on Saturday, but I couldn't marathon on Saturday, so I'm going to be playing like a hideous amount of games over the next 2 weeks, and all donations are accepted through the end of the year to count towards this year's Extra Life. So be sure to donate if you haven't already, and thank you for doing so if you do. With that out of the way, what have you guys been up to?
Not a lot on my part. I just put in a few more hours into World of Final Fantasy.
For full reference, it's only been like, what, 4 or 5 days since the last podcast. But we're really dedicated, and we don't want to skip any weeks. So here we are. So that's it.
I wouldn't say much has changed, except that I managed to get to go back and find the mini versions of the three famous summons, Ifrit, Shiva, and Ramu.
Interesting.
And so now that I have all three, I just put them all in my party and I'm racing them up.
Sweet. So are they actually summons, or are they part of your party?
Part of the party, yeah. Everything
interesting
apart from the human characters are part of your party. There's a new, I just discovered one extra layer in that normally you get small, medium, and large creatures, and you can have your human characters or your player characters be either medium or large, depending on how you prefer your stack to stack around it. So you can normally the progression is going from a small creature to a medium creature, then large. And for some, there's an extra level, which I've just recently discovered, called extra large. And that's rather than being the large slot, which would be the bottom slot, it takes up all of the slots, basically. So it's kind of like a summon in a different way, in that you summon it in like you would, like if you were Yuna in FFX,
right.
Summon it in and it takes over, and you've got your two player characters, which stand on the hands, or at least in the creature I saw, stand on the hands of the extra large creature you have, and then you battle like that for a limited time.
That sounds awesome.
Yeah, it's an extra
You keep talking about this game, and I was very much on the verge of buying it like half an hour ago. So that'll probably happen before the end of the day, because I just finished the Titanfall campaign.
I would say don't spoil for yourself which human characters are summons, because you might find some of... I don't want to get your hopes up for your favorites coming back, but you get a few unexpected player characters, human characters that reappear as summons.
Yeah, as long as my boy Vivi's in there, I'm good.
No promises.
No, God. No, I've totally seen screenshots. He's in the game somewhere. So I want him to come along in the party at some point. However he comes, I don't care. Better come. I know it's unreasonable, but I love Vivi. So I signed up for GameSpot, almost 20 years ago, and he has been my avatar on there like ever since. It's just like a little picture of him. So it's a small thing. It's a small thing, but it's a sentimental thing. So that it for you this week?
Yeah, I'd say so. I mean, over the weekend, I did get distracted with the same person as last week dragging me back in to play the same game as last week.
That shall not be mentioned.
Yeah, I mean, Ace is right here, so I can't really talk about him, but except in the same person.
Yes.
Yeah.
not Ace, but totally Ace. So, yeah. Ace, tell us about it.
Yeah, so since Friday, I did a tiny bit of PlayStation VR Worlds. But not a lot. I need to need to spend more time on that. But got distracted with Prince over the weekend. We indulged in the of war.
Oh.
In
Was
the
it gruesome? We can say the
uh,
name. It's
it
not
it
hard.
was gruesome. Yes, it was
Lot,
definitely. It was
lots of
the
giblets.
it was the Major League Gaming ladder and tournament for a exclusive community skin. And I thought,
Interesting.
what the heck? Let's go for it. I've never done that before. I've never been in Major League Gaming or any kind of competition thing like that. It's never sort of really attracted me, but I thought, hey, why not for a free skin, and it'd be an interesting experience. And it certainly was. Certainly was. The ladder that we did, though, I looked around the Discord and found someone who was doing a team, and got involved in that. And then I dragged Prince in to fill out another spot.
Yeah, he's like, oh, it's
Took some
fine. We don't
convincing.
need no pressure. We can just play,
Was
and
it?
it'll just be like 3 matches. It's fine. No worry.
Yeah,
So I'm thinking
it
like, oh, great. We'll be done in an hour. That's cool. I can do that.
That's fine.
Not quite though.
No.
They were a pretty cool team actually. They were nice and laid back. Some of them are like really into it and crazy. But yeah, we were just like, let's have a go. But yeah, we kind of didn't think we had much of a chance, and yeah, that certainly opened our eyes. We were unlucky enough in our first match to get
Like an
a game,
actual
yeah,
team.
an actual esports team.
Ooh, that must have been an experience.
It was
25-2 or something.
well, 7-0 they won.
Yeah.
The first round I think was over in 30 seconds, which probably includes the time of the countdown, the spawn protection, and about the time it takes to get halfway across the map. So we probably only actually survived for 15 seconds, I think. But you in the
Right.
entire
Well,
team
it
of
was
five.
domination, and safe to say they dominated, so. Yeah.
But by the last round, we did manage to get it up to a slightly more respectable 2 minutes 58 seconds. So, we actually improved through the course of the match, which is all you can really hope for, really.
Right.
And I think I shot one of them, surprisingly.
You did damage.
No, I killed one of them. I actually got a kill on there. I was like, wow, I did not think that would happen. And he had a torque bow, and I just had it was an Asher, and I don't even think I was that close to him. But I thought I was doomed when I saw what he had. He had a power weapon. I thought, oh, I've had it.
Yep, I
But
think he was just me at the time, but I don't know. I've played plenty of games against really, really good players, and it can be so demoralizing. But if you manage to do anything against those people, it's always a good feeling.
And hopefully we get a skin out of it, whereas sort of normally playing the competitive probably just get ripped apart. But it was an interesting thing to do. I'm not sure if I'm like Prince would be too game to go and do it again, but
I would say I would not recommend under any circumstance, even if there were 5 skins given out, I would not.
if there
That
were
bad,
five
huh?
skins, they could convince me to have another go if there was more skins, I should think.
Basically,
But
it cost us about 4 hours at least, and that was for 3 games because there was a lot of faffing about and waiting. Because the MLG site is basically like it was built in the 90s, and you
I think
sign
it was
up.
actually built in the early 2000s,
Yeah, I
so
know,
not
but I'm
far
saying
off.
it's like it basically is a joke.
That bad.
Sorry, MLG, but I don't know if we're planning on getting sponsorship from MLG. Obviously, we're not. But
You never know.
basically, I can
Hey,
speak honestly.
we maintain our editorial independence.
That's true. We maintain our liberty to speak out against MLG for nobody that cares. But basically,
What I
yeah,
would say is
rather than
it did
having.
highlight to me.
Well, I would say what they should have done, because the makers of Gears of War 4, the Coalition, have obviously paired up with MLG to make this skin, because not only have they coded it into the game, but they've put up notifications in the game to say, sign up for MLG. So rather than making a playlist, not a playlist, well, yeah, a playlist, so you can go and search and you can find other people, and that way you can do the ladder and the tournament. Rather than doing any of that work, they basically just make you sign up for the website, and then you post up your match, like it's looking for games or something like that, like something really unrelated to the system. And then you have to wait for, we waited for over an hour, I think, for the first match to show up. And that was the pro team that basically just knocks on our door and they're like, yeah, you have to come now. We're in the middle of a multiplayer game. Never mind. You have to come now. I mean, I don't know why they couldn't have waited, because we'd waited like an hour. But yeah, I mean, basically just bad times all around. And I'm not complaining about the losing. It's just the whole experience was just a joke. There was nothing good about the experience.
It sounds like, to me, it sounds like that the MLG site has not changed in forever, which is kind of a problem. Because, like, I remember dabbling around on the MLG site at one point. And this may have been back originally when they were, like, working on stuff with Westwood and, like, Command & Conquer. I might be making that up. But I do remember trying to use that site, and it was just, like, they had an entire, like, booklet on how to handle setting up games and things like that. It was just, it was a disaster, and it took forever, and it was very rigid, and it doesn't sound like it was a great system.
Yeah, I think Ace was the one who, well, one of the ones who read the rules, and I don't know how long that took you, but it sounded so much more convoluted than it needed to be.
Yeah, I don't envy the people who are the leaders, because they've got a lot to think about and do, and procedure and stuff, and time to report things in, and there's a lot of rules, and if you don't follow them, then you get penalties and stuff, which it's all quite serious, isn't it? I think they could do with some different tiers and levels. So fine, if you're like esports professionals, it's all you ever do, you're semi sort of living off of that. It's fine in one category, but then another category, more of a casual. I mean, when I looked back at it for like all the tournaments and things that are available, there was an icon for amateur, and I looked down and not one of them actually was amateur. So it's like, I mean, you need some more tiers so that, someone who's just having a go for a bit of fun doesn't necessarily get matched up against an esports professionals. And we're talking real professionals. They're these are the guys that have got the jumpsuits. They've been to the things,
Meanwhile, we're just a ragtag group of me and Ace who are just playing together, and then three other guys that we've never met before in our lives.
Crazy stuff. But I have to agree. It's probably one of the most off-putting things when you're just in it to have a good time, even if you're being semi-competitive. Like, there needs to be a sort of video game equivalent of like an intramural level, you know, where it's competitive, you've got teams, but you're not here to like kill people. You're here to have a good time, and if you happen to win, then that's good too, you know, because sometimes after the first few weeks, if you're not keeping up with a game, you just get slaughtered, you know, even for mid-tier stuff. But anyways, with that out of the way, I've been playing Skyrim Special Edition. Right. Not a whole lot, just a little bit, just toying around with it. In full disclosure, I'm not playing on the PlayStation. I'm playing on PC because it was free. I had, if you had all the stuff previously on PC, they just gave you the special edition for free. So I was like, okay. And you know, that's doubly good because, you know, there's not a lot of mods on PS4 right now. So
look back at our previous podcast about PlayStation and mods.
apparently doing slightly better. There are some mods, and I think just today I saw something about it was confirmed that mods were coming to Fallout 4 and hopefully within the next month. But that still doesn't mean that it's going to happen. So, but the last count I heard was something in the vicinity of like Xbox One had something around 70 mods, and PlayStation, I don't think, had broken into the double digits yet. So that's pretty unfortunate. But on PC, it's all there. And like the Nexus has an entirely new section for special edition stuff, because some of the modding elements are different. But theoretically, I guess you could actually use older mods. They'd just probably break. But I downloaded some mods and did the different start thing, the second life or whatever it was. But for the most part, I kind of just went and checked it out vanilla to see what it looked like. And it looks all right. It is definitely better. The textures are slightly higher resolution, but the meshes are still not great. The animations, I don't think, have been improved at all. So it's really funny because, like, the animations are super rickety last-gen animations. So people move very oddly, and they're kind of stilted. But it's still Skyrim, so it's still plenty of fun to be had there. And then I also ended up playing Titanfall 2 more, and I just finished the campaign for that today, which was awesome. So a lot of people have been, like, up or down on the Titanfall 2 campaign. Some people are absolutely loving it and adore it and think it's, you know, the best thing since sliced bread. And some people are like, yeah, it's okay. It's serviceable. So
which side do you
fall? I ended up playing.
Which side do you lean towards?
So here's the interesting thing. I was seeing people on Twitter keep going back and forth. And I was kind of leaning towards the latter. Like, I could see that the game was well designed, but I really wasn't having as much fun as I would normally expect I would. Like, I love the heck out of Titanfall multiplayer, and I was just not having anywhere near as much fun. And about halfway through the game, it kind of occurred to me that maybe the reason why was because I was playing it like a regular shooter. Obviously, you have to do the wall running and whatever, and there's platforming and stuff, and that's crucial to the game.
If you touch the ground, you've messed up.
Pretty much. But the problem, I think, was I was playing the game on hard, and when you play on hard or, like, legendary or veteran or whatever, when you play in the harder difficulties, usually the way to succeed is to be more conservative. And that's obviously what I was doing. So I was playing a lot more from cover rather than running around like a crazy person. And I was dying more often, which comes with the territory, and that's fine. But it's a game about running around and being fluid and, you know, being lightweight. And that's not the kind of game that I was playing. So I bumped it down to the regular difficulty, normal, and I played the latter half and I had a blast.
When was it?
So
finishing or
that it
partway through.
I was about halfway through and I just changed the difficulty, which I never do that. I'm too stubborn and I'm just like, you know what? I'm going to stick it through and just get through this. But I just kind of hit a point and I was like, you know what? I'm not having that much fun. Why don't I give it a shot? And the latter half of the game was stellar. Of course, that could just be that the latter half was better designed. and it seemed like the jump in difficulty from regular to hard was actually pretty large, because I didn't really die almost at all once I changed the difficulty down one
step.
Maybe
you finally got good.
I got good. But I don't think that was it. Like, it was just, I had more fun running around and maybe more crucially, I could experiment more. And if I experimented and I got really beat up, but I didn't die, then I could learn something and improve. And whereas before, like, I was getting beat over the head for running around. And so I withdrew, and the thing that was making me succeed was withdrawing, not playing aggressively. So I wasn't really learning how to play any differently. I wasn't improving. So I think playing on regular is just, even if you're a veteran Titanfall player, is probably the way to go, just because it is more fluid. You're not constantly dying and disrupting that feeling of fluidity. But just my two cents. I would definitely recommend giving it a go on regular before hard. As a side note, one of the people that I saw that was very kind of on it was Colin Moriarty, who is notorious for playing hard games, and he played it on the hardest difficulty. So maybe anecdotally, that's kind of what's happening to other people. Maybe that's why people are so split. Maybe some people are just playing on easier difficulties and enjoying the running around and the platforming. Because I think even with the difficulty reduced, my least favorite parts of the game were when I was on the ground shooting. Being in the Titan, running around, playing it like a platforming game was way more interesting than the standing on the ground shooting. So
how many difficulties are there?
Four. So you got easy, regular, hard, and master.
Okay, so playing on the hardest. I assume that one's, is that unlocked from the start?
Yeah, it's actually all unlocked from the start. So you do
so
have
you
that
play
option.
On that one,
well,
that's
I think
be a real tough time.
Yeah, and I, you know, it's one of those things. Like I look at it, and I'm kind of interested for people that beat it on master, just based on the way that I was playing it. Is the way to play it on master to play super conservatively? Because that kind of breaks the tenets of Titanfall. Or do you really just have to be a freaking ninja to be able to beat the game on master, you know? I'm not really sure. At some point, maybe I'll go back and give it
I'm
a go.
I'm reminded of
but I'll probably get
another, well, an old game, which is now not old, if you think about it. Modern Warfare. In that
yeah.
game... For I think veteran was the hardest on that, wasn't it? Or what was it?
Mm.
Okay,
yeah,
so playing that on the hardest difficulty through the main game, it was always a slog. You sort of fight for the next checkpoint, and you do have to play conservatively,
right.
kind of survival the grenades. Mm. I think World at War was more infamous for having more grenades, but certainly Modern Warfare was a tough time. And then conversely, after completing. I think most people will probably do it in the same order. After completing the main game on the hardest difficulty, by playing so conservatively and slowly fighting for every next checkpoint, then you play my high club, and the whole thing has to be played at blitz. There's no other way.
Yeah,
because it's timed.
Yeah. I love that achievement. By the way, I totally got that. That was a lot of fun. But yeah, and I think when you're playing Call of Duty on veteran, I think it's fundamentally different because when you die, it's you just jump right back into what you were doing before, which is why you're there. Whereas with Titanfall, that's not really the case. You know, you die and you end up back on the ground standing still, and that's not what you want to be doing. You know, when you're playing Call of Duty, you hit that sprint button, you're going and you're playing again. But for Titanfall, you have to get back into your momentum. It's not just going and running and shooting. It's finding that momentum again. And so every time you die, you're disrupting that, and it's a little bit jarring.
Sounds like playing Mario Kart when you were playing as Bowser or Donkey Kong.
Yeah, kind of. it's just once I bump the difficulty down, I mean, you kind of felt like a badass, but it was a lot of fun. Like there were points where I just run through a group of people and slide and then shoot like five people standing around me, and I felt awesome. But I definitely think that's the way to go. It keeps the pace of the game going. It keeps the pace of the story going, which is not that great if the story drags, but is plenty of fun in a sort of cheesy way if you're really moving through it at a decent tempo.
I think I don't know if this is too much of a big question. Actually, maybe we can come back to it in the topic of the week.
Sure, sounds good. So let's move on then, and we'll get to. There's been some news, not a lot, but BlizzCon did happen. They did announce that the Necromancer would be coming to Diablo 3, but with some tweaks. You guys play any Diablo?
I haven't played any.
Nope.
Oh, dear. I haven't played in a while. But the most important part of this is people love the Necromancer from, what was it, Diablo 2, and they're going to be bringing it back after a sort, but they're going to be changing stuff because there's a lot of overlap between what the Necromancer was and what the Witch Doctor is now, since they're both pet classes. So they summon stuff and the stuff fights for them for the most part. And the result is that I guess they're going to be changing the Necromancer a little bit so that it's more tactical. Whereas the Witch Doctor, you summon stuff and it goes and it fights for you and then you do other stuff. The Necromancer is going to be slightly more tactical, but they don't want to turn it into an RTS is what they're saying. So you will be able to summon your mobs and send them off to go and fight certain things. And then when you're like, oh my God, there's this big bad guy, I'm going to have them go attack that thing. You can actually tell them to go attack the big thing, which is pretty cool.
Good.
They are also, and a side note, if I remember correctly, they're bringing back like a filter and some of the bosses from the original Diablo. But that was, I don't remember exactly the details mm-hmm. behind that one. You sounded like you were going to say something.
No, I'm just, I suppose it's good that they're bringing another amazed. Character after, it's been quite a while for Diablo 3.
Yeah, it'll be nice for them to have another character, something else to play after you've, you know, maxed out everything else. Hopefully you'll enjoy it. Some people are really upset about the changes to the Necromancer, so can't please everybody though. And then in Overwatch, the other really, really, really big property that Blizzard has, Sombra was finally confirmed. Originally, rumors were suggesting that she might be a pet class, actually. But it turns out that she's more of like an infiltrator. She'll have a cloak and the ability to teleport. And what else? She's got a pistol to use and... She seems like she'll be a fun character. Oh, she can hack people and sort of mess up their cooldowns and things like that.
Interesting.
Very interesting. I figured it's worth mentioning. A lot of people play that game. I didn't. You guys didn't seem to be Overwatch people, but there are a lot of people that are.
Yeah.
In news that I'm sure a lot more people around here are probably excited for, yesterday was N7 Day, so they released a new trailer for Mass Effect Andromeda. Did you guys have thoughts?
Yeah, Ace, do you want to go first on that?
Very exciting. Love the production values. Yeah, it's very interesting. Nice to see close up the a new protagonist, isn't it, now?
Yeah.
And the protagonist.
Twins. Yeah.
Siblings.
And new vehicles. And looks impressive. I'm sure it's going to be very
between
popular.
The male and the female character, which do you think you would go for?
So I apparently made the mistake, and I never knew this, of playing as male Shep instead of Fem Shep. Apparently Fem Shep was definitely the way to go.
Well, it's
relative. Yeah, it just from everything that I've heard and from what I've seen, apparently the voice acting and the character is a little bit more interesting. So maybe I'd be making the mistake again, but I don't know anything about these characters. I think maybe the brother looks a little more interesting. I don't know. He looks a little bit younger too, but I'm not sure about that. So I looked at him and just his character design seemed a little bit more brash and juvenile.
Yeah, I can see that.
So I feel like maybe he might be the more interesting character. But
is it?
We'll see.
I mean, I haven't done too much reading on Mass Effect Andromeda partly because I don't want to spoil anything for myself. But mm-hmm. I suppose it's a given at this point that the character's not customizable anymore.
Oh no, the custom, as far as I'm aware, it is still customizable. You'll be able to change the characteristics. I'm not sure how much, because I have to imagine that if you make changes to your character, they have some method of perhaps changing your sibling.
Oh, right.
You know, just
like GK's, you know, family, genes.
Yeah. Yeah. At least that way, you know, there's, you don't end up with two people that look completely unrelated, though theoretically, I guess it's possible, you know, but I think it would be jarring for people.
Yeah. So I was thinking, the reason I asked it is because we get a proper look at Mel Ryder in the trailer. And you mentioned about Fem Shep in previous entries. I think Fem Shep was very good, but the reason why I don't think you did wrong is because a lot of men, when they had the opportunity of a customizable character, want to customize it either after themselves or as something that is sort of amusing for themselves. And similarly, for ladies, they might fashion after themselves or fashion as like a caricature female. So now when you look at what's ahead, you can have that choice again. You might want a rider that's a lot like you, or you might want someone very different. And with FemShep, she was very good on the default, but if you customize her or use a different voice, you know, it's anything else. So I wouldn't say you've missed out. You missed out on one of the, I think probably there were six voices. And in terms of appearance, you haven't missed out on anything, because that was the default. It was an option. I did play FemShep for Mass Effect 3, one run through. But prior to that, I always played three different male characters. So I'm just kind of trying to defend you a little bit.
Yeah. Just as a side note on the related topic of choosing characters, this was a couple of years ago. It's an old article, but GameSpot, one of the guys that worked there, did a maybe two videos on how we design our characters. And it's got some statistics about, you know, what men and women typically do with their characters and things like that. It was an episode of Reality Check, so it'd be hard to find, but if you can find it, it's very interesting.
Sure.
So they released the trailer. We did get our first official look at the brother rider, which I don't think we'd seen before. We'd seen mostly the sister, I think. And then we also, they told us that loyalty missions will be coming back, though these are apparently not critical. Whereas in Mass Effect 2, if you didn't do the loyalty mission, then odds are that it would result in somebody dying.
Huh? Spoiler alert, I was trying to throw in.
Oh, well, yes and no. That was part of the marketing. Okay. So I don't know that it's necessarily that spoilery unless you really paid attention. I guess it's more likely that I would have spoiled it now for people that just weren't paying attention back then. So sorry about that. Yes, it's fantastic. Definitely play it.
A very a pivotal feature in Mass Effect 2 that you were sort of compelled to do the loyalty missions for all of your squad, because if you didn't do the loyalty missions, they would be vulnerable to dying in the suicide mission. I mean, it's a suicide mission, so I suppose that should be a given. But the way to protect them is to get to know them properly and to do what's important to them so that they can focus on the mission. And the alternative here in Andromeda seems to be that you can do them just because you want to get to know the character, or just because you want to help the character, not because some guidebook says you have to do it, because if you don't, you're going to regret it at the end. For other reasons.
Yeah, and it strikes me as, so I think it does make the character maybe a little bit more powerful or whatever, but they are definitely clear that it is optional. It's not going to like randomly result in people dying. It's more just an option. If you want to do it, if you find the character interesting, then you can explore more about that character. And then this was just something that I picked up when they were talking about it, was they did say that you could complete them after the main storyline too, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, that's it.
So it does seem, I mean, not that that's overly surprising, because I, for the most part, as long as everything went okay in the first two games, at least, you could continue playing after the credits rolled. And then the third one was, you know, rather final. Yes. So there wasn't really much to do afterwards, but. And then let's see, they leaked details, and we got some box art. They basically explained pretty much everything that we already know about the game, or at least expected about the story and whatnot. Let's see, I lost track of it. You are going to be the Pathfinder, yada, yada. Apparently Mr. Krabs is playing your father.
Okay. Who's that?
Mr. Krabs, SpongeBob.
Oh, okay.
I thought that's what you said. I thought, what?
He has a name, I'm sure. A real name.
Eugene Krabs. Yeah, basically they just released a bunch of details accidentally on the Amazon page that tells you things about the game, but they may not actually make it into the final game. So who knows? At this point, it's probably just about finished anyway. So it's a safe bet that these elements will make it into the game. You make your choices. Huh?
SpongeBob SquarePants.
Yes. Whether or not your SpongeBob SquarePants friends will survive.
Is that the new galaxy that we're going to, the SpongeBob galaxy?
Yeah, believe it or not, the entire galaxy
Wait,
is underwater.
Wait, is he the villain?
Yes.
Plankton.
Uh-huh. Right. Anyway, so it's going to have four-player and multiplayer, so it seems like it's going to be something reminiscent of maybe what they had in Mass Effect 3, okay. But we don't know. Destructible environments. And a more flexible progression tree for skills and weapons.
Well, that's good.
But, yeah, I think it's kind of, we expected, I'm sure, most of that stuff. I am not surprised by the inclusion of multiplayer.
I'm still not sure how I feel about Mass Effect 3's multiplayer. I kind of, after I stopped playing it, it was, well, I suppose that's kind of the nature of shooters. You play it and then it's over, but I kind of,
yeah,
regret that it's not got any future to it, in a way.
Yeah. I think it was enjoyable. Enjoyable enough, at least. And then, what else? Did you want to tell us about The Division? You seem to have a better handle on it than I.
So, this is the next paid DLC for The Division. Well, primarily the next paid DLC. The paid part is called Survival, mm-hmm. and the free part is called 1.5, patch 1.5.
Glamorous.
So they haven't quite announced the release date for it, but certainly they've started doing PTS, which is what they call public test server.
Right.
And basically they have like, well, it's kind of like a in-progress version of the game, which people can test on PC only at the moment.
Mm-hmm.
They did that for the 1.4 changes, and it was very successful. They had, I think, 3 weeks, and every week they gave it some more revisions so people could give feedback as it went, as it updated. So that was very successful in the past. So now, hopefully, we're again counting on our PC player kin again to refine the game, or refine the survival part of the game before we get it. The only downside, I would say, is for PS4, there's still the delay, the exclusivity delay.
Yeah.
So we'll be getting patch 1.5, which comes with nobody knows what at this point.
Right.
And then probably a month later, we'll get the survival DLC, even though we've already paid for it. Well, some of us have already paid for it, which I increasingly start to regret. But
yeah.
Hopefully there's some good things in 1.5 that will come out. But I'm starting to think more and more that I just won't play it until Survival comes, which could be 2 months away at this point. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, that's always the gamble, I guess. And it's kind of unfortunate because, you know, you usually look at something like this and you're like, oh, well, you know, it's Ubisoft. So even if it's not great, eventually it's going to come out. But with the way things have gone for The Division, it's kind of been slow going as they try to, like, get it to be a, I don't know, slightly more respectable game. Not that it was bad. I mean, I enjoyed what I played, but it did have especially like economy issues and things. So it's a little too bad that it's taking all of this effort to get to a state that they're happy with and that it's taking so long to do so.
Yeah. Well, 1.4 is out now. It came out, I think, last week. 1.4 is the one that fixes everything that they aim to fix. They completely rebalanced the game, which is good. But now we're just getting extra content, so that's also good.
Yeah, hopefully that'll come at a better pace now that they've got everything straightened out.
Yes, true. They delayed this for that.
Mm-hmm.
And hopefully after this, then they can look at the next paid DLC coming out more snappily.
Yeah.
It's open.
Yep.
As for content, I mean, they haven't given out a lot of very useful details at this point. The short summary of it, there you can find a lot of the full details online, but the short summary of it is basically each survival expedition is a sort of 1.5 to 2 hour foray into the open world. It's a modified version of the open world, which is hugely affected by blizzards, snowstorms, if there's a difference. And you are going out with basically completely reset gear, and you have to find things, you have to scavenge, and you have to... The survival part of it is kind of a double meaning, in that it's kind of like a survival horror, stands the horror, in that you have to... well, I suppose that's just a survival game. Other people probably have played survival games. I've never played something that's exclusively survival, but tangent. You have to go and find water, and you have to find food, and you have to keep your temperature up. So it's kind of... I've seen a similar thing actually in the new Tomb Raider, but I'm not going to say it's copied, because it definitely isn't.
Right.
But yeah, it's certainly got that kind of desperate vibe, which take the Division back to its root. Well, take a high level Division player back to their roots, in a way that you have to scavenge for gear with actual benefits coming around every turn, and you have to kind of avoid enemies a little bit, because not because they're ridiculously overpowered, but because you're ridiculously underpowered.
Right.
And things like that. And there's hope, because obviously you're going to find better gear.
Right. Sounds interesting. If I kept up with a game, I might have even played it.
Yeah. Well, I suppose maybe down the line, you could... I'd probably wait at least until... I would say there's not much point jumping in right now. Wait until after Sorrow's out. Maybe the one after that could get the season pass on sale, and that might be a good time to jump in and see what's on offer. But this survival is designed to be accessible even for new players, in that everyone going into the arena, not the arena, but the survival expedition is at the same level.
Yeah, so equal footing. Cool. In other news, GameStop says the new October games have underperformed.
Ah.
Yes. Well,
But this is physical.
Right. So this is GameStop. So this only counts things that they may have sold. So that doesn't necessarily mean that it doesn't include digital, but for the most part, it doesn't include digital, because they mostly just sell boxed copies. So in this case, it seems like they sold less games physical than they expected.
Right.
Yeah.
And this includes Battlefield 1, doesn't it?
I mean, so this is new October games, so that would include the very tail end. So, I mean, it would include like Titanfall and what have you. And by extension, Battlefield, because that was the week before, I think. So it does include those games. Battlefield obviously being a much bigger seller, and I would presume a bigger seller in physical form than Sun Games, just because it's a more, what's the word I'm looking for? It appeals to a wider audience. You know, it's not just the sort of hardcore gamer that buys everything digitally. It appeals to everybody. So...
Like people who pick up off the shelf when browsing.
Yep. It does also include, if I am not mistaken, when did Mafia 3 come out?
That was earlier, so maybe early October, or if not before.
I just, out of curiosity, so October 7th, which is curious, because it was announced that was the fastest selling property for 2K, right? So
but holding back reviews,
yeah, right. See our previous episode for that one. So I don't know, it's interesting that GameStop is saying this, because we've not heard anything necessarily, not yet. I mean, it might still be a little while before we hear anything, but plenty of game developers have come out and just been like, man, that did not work out. So I feel like that is probably not entirely the case. I'm sure we're just seeing maybe even a faster increase in digital sales than we anticipated.
I feel like that is probably part of it. I feel like mm-hmm. digital sales are kind of a hidden behemoth in the room. But also, I heard that Titanfall 2 is quite severely underperformed.
Yeah, that does seem to be the case, which is super unfortunate because it is actually, it's a very fun game and it is bringing with it exactly what people asked for. However, even if it is underperforming, it's not surprising, at least to me, that it's underperforming. This is, it released 1 week after Battlefield and 1 week before Call of Duty. Literally the two terrible biggest shooters we've ever seen. And this game released smack dab between them. Because it's like, that's the dumbest thing. Like, it's not surprising compared to Titanfall 1 that it's not doing well. Even though it's on two different platforms, so was the original Titanfall. That came out on 360 as well, which had an install base of 80 million units.
Right. Forgot about that.
Right. This is only next gen. So it's only PS4 and Xbox One and PC, obviously. So it's an equal number of platforms. And the last game came out in, what was it, March or something? So, I mean, it had room to breathe. It didn't get slaughtered by, you know, everybody being busy playing something else.
Yeah.
So
I think... Well, part of it is, I mean, EA sort of makes the excuse that people who want to play Titanfall are looking for that very specific avenue of gameplay.
Right.
But then from our circles, from the people that we would first speak to about playing these games, if you're a shooter fan, you've had all of these as an option and you would have eliminated... probably at least one of them. So you're not saying, oh, I'm looking for a shooter this month, Titanfall 2. You say, Battlefield 1.
Yeah.
Or Call of Duty.
Well, and I think that's kind of the problem you run into is not even necessarily that it came out after Battlefield, which is a dumb decision, I think, for EA, but that it came out a week before Call of Duty. Because... even though Titanfall does a lot of things better than Call of Duty, it's still Call of Duty. And so the overlap there of the fast gameplay, especially now, you know, that Call of Duty has incorporated all the acrobatics and whatever into the game, you have so much overlap, and it's not even down to which one does it better. It just comes down to the fact that it does it well enough. And everybody is going to be playing that. All of your friends who don't play games normally are going to pick that one up. So even if you bought Titanfall, what are the odds that you're going to play it beyond the campaign if all of your friends are playing Call of Duty? You know?
If it had been at another time, you might have people who had bought only Call of Duty and then they're getting tired of it or they're waiting for the next one and they're looking for an alternative to play. Titanfall 2. Perfectly fits the alternative.
Exactly. And it was just the wrong time to release that game.
Yeah, but bad timing. Flooded it, I think.
I think, though, too, that I do have to say that I feel like this October, for some reason, has been really anticlimactic for me. And I don't know that I can put my finger on why. Titanfall was one of my favorite games a few years ago, and I love Gears of War. But for some reason, it just... I don't know. I didn't really feel like anything delivered like something awesome for me.
Yikes.
Yeah. I don't know. Maybe it's just me. It's just, and I feel like maybe this is other people too. Like the games from October kind of came and went. Even Battlefield is like, people are like, oh wow, Battlefield has a good campaign. And then that was it. Like nobody really talked about it much after that. Mafia 3 had its day and whatever else, but October has kind of already been completely forgotten, which if you look back at the previous years, it's like you get around to November and some people are like, oh yeah, I'm still totally playing Metal Gear Solid or whatever, you know. But there's just like none of the games seem to have had staying power from October.
Wow, really? Okay.
Except for maybe, you know, VR stuff.
I was going to say, does that include VR stuff as well? Or is it just kind of like the shooters? It seems surprising.
I mean, that's what I hear about, I think, maybe more, is people talking about VR. Not necessarily one particular thing about VR, but just VR in general.
Hmm.
Maybe that's why. I don't know.
Is it underperforming because maybe people, there's just so many games in October, a lot of people are leaving it till later, November, December, Christmas.
Or vice versa. Maybe people are just playing so many different things that there's not as much conversation happening around certain focal points. I don't know.
Hmm.
I mean, there was a lot. I mean, if you look at the release schedules for October, there was a lot of stuff coming out. So,
yeah, I mean, it's a bit of everything, isn't there? Mafia, Titanfall, Call of Duty, Gears of War. I mean, there's not a lot you're really missing, really, is there?
Yeah. Yep. I don't know. Who knows? We shall see eventually. The NPD numbers, I don't think, have come out yet.
What have we got for November?
The only one that matters ends in 15.
What? Oh, Final Fantasy. Anyways.
What other game series goes up to 15? There's like three.
So you said, so I think we've gotten to the topic of the week. Did you want to discuss that?
Well, yeah, I would say, well, maybe we can have a sort of two halves topic of the week.
Sure.
What I was wondering earlier, which I thought was a bit of a discussion question. Well, I'd say that because it's a bit controversial. I'm going to throw it out there. I was wondering, how do we feel about people who professionally review games while having... I'm going to say this in the most offensive way, and please forgive me, but... That's part of the idea.
Yeah.
How do we feel about people who professionally review games having played it wrong?
It's kind of tough because it's like what is technically the right way? And theoretically the right way is whichever way you have the most fun, right? So
possibly. If it's a game about fun.
Well, yeah. I mean, don't get me wrong, like there are some games that are just not about that. If you think of comes to mind, Spec Ops: The Line is not a game about having fun.
I can imagine if you did that on the hardest difficulty and slogged your way through, it could feel relevant.
Yeah, right.
I take that back. I remember playing that on the hardest difficulty after playing it on the easier one, and that was nightmarishly hard. So I think the pacing would be destroyed if you did that. But
yeah, I kind of agree. But yeah, in a way, I don't know. That's a tough thing to answer. I feel like it's whatever you get the most enjoyment out of is technically the right way to play it. I don't know that there really is any other way of looking at it.
Objectively. Yeah, well, that's why you'd check multiple sources, wouldn't you? Rather than just the one.
Certainly.
Yeah.
I mean, there's no question that some reviews are more relevant to you than others. And certainly there's a very good place for reviews for other people who play it on the hardest difficulty, if that's your style as well. But in terms of a broader peer review, a review that's not putting itself as a niche, a review that's putting itself as a broad assessment of the game, does it not need to fall in line with the design of the game? Because you could say, I mean, to put it as an extreme, if you played the game with, I'm trying to put it in a certain way. If you played it with one hand eating a sandwich, and then you criticize the game for being cumbersome, would not the blame be on you?
Right. And certainly, I remember at one point hearing somebody, you know, there was a review and it was like, yeah, after the first level, the sound design was so terrible that I turned off the music and the sound. And it's like, but you still have to evaluate the sound design for the rest of the game. You can't just like decide not to do that. But at the same time, like I was playing No Man's Sky and it was very obvious that it was very repetitive. Like there was no real change to the music or the sound design or anything. And so I turned it off. So is that okay? Like me sitting there playing that game and listening to a podcast, is that okay? Now, granted, I didn't do that until after I finished reviewing the game, but it still kind of begs the question, like, at that I had reached a point where nothing was changing. I understood that. Did I need to subject myself to that, you know?
Yeah.
And I think the answer is, to a certain extent, yes, because, you know, if it continues to impact your gameplay, then that is worth mentioning. But at the same time, you do also have the ability to change that. So if I have the ability to change something that is negatively impacting my game experience and I don't, am I complicit in that in some way?
Yeah.
You know? Now, granted,
that's a good way to loop it back to...
Now, granted, the podcasts that I was listening to, that's something else outside. That's not a matter of changing something or whatever. That adds nothing to the game and should not be considered. But yeah, I mean, it's a tough thing, and it's something that realistically, it's kind of, there's really no other medium that has to deal with that, really. I mean, in some ways you kind of do, maybe with movies. It's like, well, maybe the proper way to watch, I don't know, Dawn of the Dead is, you know, the middle of the night with all the lights off, you know, but that's about the extent of the control that you have over a movie.
Yeah. Or, if you kept interrupting it every 5 minutes to go and, like, take a phone call or go and make tea every 5 minutes or something.
Yeah. And I think that does come down to, you shouldn't ever rely on one review, because if you rely on multiple reviews from multiple people, that's going to mitigate that did they play it correctly thing. Because you do, to some extent, I think you can presume that most people that do this for a living are good enough that even if one or two play it incorrectly, in quotes, that the rest would play it in a manner that is suitable. And even if that's not the case, for instance, like I said, Colin Moriarty, if you are the type of person that loves to play games on hard and you follow him and he's that type of person, then his opinion might be more relevant to you. So it is also important to find reviewers that do things in a certain way that are useful to you, or that you can generally agree with, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And just to clarify, I do respect Colin Moriarty. I just wanted to put it blunt.
That's the other thing is, like, can you really say that he played it incorrectly? And I can't say that I would. I mean, I think that the developer can't tell you how to play it. I mean, they can tell you what buttons do what, but they can't really tell you what's the best way to play it. They can only really recommend that this way might be beneficial, you know?
But I don't want to jump into the whole video games as art thing, but there is an element of creators of intent. And if you completely eschew the creator's intent in order to brute force it your own way, then sure, the creator can't make you play it right, but you're not playing it right by doing that.
Right.
Do you see what I mean?
But then it gets even murkier when it's like, okay, so what about Grand Theft Auto? You know? So it's like, whatever the developer may have intended, at the end of the day, I'm sure they're not going to tell you that you shouldn't have, you know, jumped out of a helicopter as, you know, you wiped out an entire fleet of tanks with the helicopter and parachuted onto the top of a mountain and whatever, you know, like, that's...
But I suppose if in the Grand Theft Auto example, I would say playing it wrong would be if you played Grand Theft Auto and you decided you're a pacifist and you just refused to shoot anything, then you're not adhering to the creator's intent.
Right.
So just don't even bother. You're not playing it right.
But, you know, if you like driving around, you know, whatever version.
That, you can't.
Yeah.
You can't assess the shooting mechanics
as a reviewer. Yeah, right. That's true.
Yeah. I mean, certainly everyone is welcome to play games in whatever obscure way they like. I mean, you've got things like the ridiculous mods in Skyrim.
Yeah.
By all means, go for it.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's not a part of the product. It's it's contorting the product to your own fun,
yeah,
which is great, but it's not part of the product.
Yeah, I mean, that's almost like, and Skyrim kind of does fit that mold. It's like, well, if there's a glitch in the game that breaks the game, but you find it really funny or enjoyable in some way, that's still not a good thing. You know, that's just, that's something that you're bringing into this experience, not really something you're getting out of it, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. I like that phrase.
Well, you've been sitting over there very quietly. Ace, did you have something to say?
Well, I just said, yeah, that's why I would get multiple sources for the reviews. For the biggest surprise and letdowns before, I guess one and the same.
Maybe we save that for some other time. Because I think that was a way better topic of discussion.
What, the one about reviews?
Yeah, especially considering last week. So maybe we'll save this one for another day. We'll I'm sure go back over what's originally our topic of the week was going to be what we were surprised by or let down by so far in the fall. But you know what? We can hold on to that for a little while longer and just discuss the whole fall.
We could do a 2016.
Yeah, we'll do a recap of 2016 or the fall or something.
Yeah, yeah.
So, did you have anything else to add to this?
Like I said, it always helps to just sort of get your own opinion, really, isn't it? There's so many methods nowadays.
Mm-hmm.
YouTube videos, streaming, PlayStation Live.
Yep. But find a person you trust. Find as many people as you can trust as you can, and that way you can be as informed as possible.
PlayStation Store demo if you're lucky.
Yeah.
Well, certainly I'm an advocate of multiple independent sources, but do you not find, if say you take the time to read a review, and if it's a good review, it's usually quite detailed, quite lengthy, so maybe you've read a large portion of a review and then you get to the end of it and you realize, hang on, this perspective is completely not agreeable with my own personal, the way I would want the reviewer to assess the game. And if you can think of any examples of that, I'm not sure if it's just me, but if you can think of any examples of that, do you then find like that review was not what it was sold as in a way, or it was a waste of time or anything else? What do you feel at the end? I shouldn't be putting ideas. What do you feel when that happens?
I honestly can't think of any one in particular. I mean, I think that just comes down to a certain level of subjectivity that you can't really get rid of, and that you can only account for in certain ways. It kind of reminds me of Everybody's Gone to the Rapture, which I quite enjoyed, but I criticized it for being kind of slow. Like, you move very slowly in that game. And as you pointed out, that is kind of important to how you play the game. But I did criticize it for that. And so I don't know, like, I think you have to kind of find, you have to be able to interpret what the person is saying and see if it applies to you. You know, like, if you are, let's say, the type of person that loves co-op games or online games or The Division, for example, where a large portion of the game can be played solo, you have to be able to sort of look at a review and see if they did, if they satisfied what you wanted to know about that game. If they played the entire game solo as much as they possibly could, and that doesn't really jive with how you would play it, that's something you need to be cognizant of. And so it's really, I think, up to the reader to try and mitigate those kinds of things and account for them as best they can. And obviously it's a good faith thing, obviously, for the reviewer to try to account for as many different ways that the game can be played as possible. You know,
I feel like in many ways, this is for me as a reader as much as a writer, I feel like in many ways it's a matter of disclosure and separation.
Sure.
So to take those two examples, if you reviewed Everybody's Gone to the Rapture and you hated the slow walk speed, which is, I hate to say, a valid concern. Then if you let that taint the entire game, maybe it ruins the fun for you, that's okay.
Right.
But if you let that taint the entire game and then you paint your picture of the entire game as dull and boring and slow-paced,
right,
because of this one aspect which you couldn't separate,
yeah,
it becomes a tainted review in my eyes. And for The Division, if you played the whole game solo and there are parts of it which are clearly designed for groups and you play it solo, and right, you never mention that you played only solo, you just say it's too hard,
right,
or something like that, you haven't properly disclosed the circumstances, right, of your constraints. And I think it's great if you do disclose up front, you've played it all solo, and this is how it plays, yeah, all solo. So if you're going for all solo, now, right, you know you can't play it. But if you don't disclose that, no one's getting information.
That's why you look at like a site like Co-Optimus or something like that, and it's like, well, yeah, you know, obviously people are starting from a very particular standpoint of playing together with people. And that's, mm-hmm, that's great. Like that is good information to have going into that. And I agree. I think a lot of that stuff needs to be covered by disclosure. And the whole point of a review is to be informative, you know, and you can't include every single morsel of your experience, obviously, but you do have to obviously consider your audience when you're writing and what they might expect that you like how you may have played. So I think, yeah, something like that is something that you have to try to account for or convey, you know, if there are limitations as to why you did it, like for whatever reason the game, you know, you played solo, but you played solo and it was fun, but you played solo because the network just didn't work, you know. It's like,
yeah,
you know, all of that information is relevant. And I think you're seeing, to a degree, things are getting much better in regards to disclosure. I mean, a lot of places include a little blurb about, well, this is the setup, this is who provided the game, etc. A lot of places are doing a lot better about informing people about that kind of stuff.
One last thing from me is, in regards to your experience with Titanfall 2, mm-hmm, you have, well, at least to us, you've disclosed your cause for concern, and in doing so you've said that the first half you didn't so much enjoy, but the second half, after you changed the difficulty, it completely changed how you felt about it. Yeah. And then you're sort of, you said earlier that you said unprovoked that you're not sure if the latter half is better because of that, but because of the information considered,
yeah,
we have the ability to assess that maybe the first half isn't as good, or maybe the first half may be good if we play with the information in mind.
Right. Yeah. And I want to try and provide as much information as possible just for reasons like that. Like I cannot be 100% sure that the second half of the game isn't just better, you know? But I have my reasons for believing that it's not necessarily that the second half is better. Like I said, I could definitely tell that there was a quality to the craftsmanship of the game, even in the first half. And for some reason, it wasn't connecting with me. And I mean, that just comes down to certain things like the way it introduced elements of the game to me and, you know, how I learned to engage with them and how I learned, you know, it very clearly presented certain indicators of, you know, well, this is where you should do a certain thing, things like that. And the explanations behind all of these things, it very clearly was well designed. Things were changing and it was introducing me to new elements very well, you know, but I just, as much as I could see those, it didn't feel like I was enjoying them as much as I should have for something that was so carefully constructed.
All right.
Well, yeah,
I don't want to start saying something again.
Yeah. I think we need to draw the line at that. Keep moving. We're running out of time at this point.
Okay.
So for releases this week, we have PSVR digital and retail. Finally, Robinson, The Journey is coming out, which was, I think, might've been a reveal game.
Yeah, I remember seeing this. This is the one with the little flying robot and the dinosaurs.
That's right.
Exactly.
Enough said.
That's all I know about the game because I was literally about to say the same exact thing.
But, yeah, that doesn't say a lot about it. It is incredibly impressive, isn't it? The depth of the world and graphics and
it
the immersion.
It looks gorgeous.
The scene where they revealed it, like you said, and there's like this huge diplodocus or something, dinosaurs treading over you, and you're trying to navigate through the brush underneath. And it looks quite interesting, doesn't it? It's certainly one for the VR experience.
And then
I'm just surprised it's releasing now. I mean, I haven't heard about it since.
Pretty much.
I haven't been reading everything, but
well,
as far as I knew, it was coming out next year, for as little as I've heard.
Yeah. Eagle Flight is kind of in the same boat, actually, because I remember when they announced it, but I've heard more about this than I have about Robinson, but not much more. Like, I forgot about it. I've heard good things.
Is there good things? Because it's £35 on the store, isn't it? So I'm hoping it's more than just flying around as a bird, because it didn't really hear much.
Is Eagle Flight
it.
The one where you explore?
I could be mistaken, but if I... I could be pulling this out of my ass.
There are two bird games, and I always get them confused, so that's why I'm asking.
I think Eagle Flight has exploration-y type stuff, but I think it's actually like a legit game, too. Capture the flag and stuff like that, but as eagles.
So the competitive...
It seems like some kind of competitive element, but...
It's multiplayer...
Double check that, because I'm not 100% sure.
Says here, multiplayer up to 6 players, use your piloting skills... To lead your team to victory in 2 multiplayer modes and engage in heart-pounding multiplayer dogfights.
Yeah.
So only 2 modes.
And 6 gameplay.
How do you engage in dogfights with eagles? You like shoot feathers at them or something?
Yeah.
It's good. It's good.
I'm a bit worried about that price point. I think that seems a bit high.
Yeah,
maybe.
PS4 digital and retail. Cartoon Network Battle Crashers. Dishonored 2 is coming out Friday. Root Letter, which is also coming out on Vita, is coming out on Thursday. And then Sword Art Online Hollow Realization is coming out today.
Okay.
Cartoon Network looks good. Always nice to see Rigby and Adventure Time in another game.
Yeah. Yeah, it looks like it's roping and everything. I still have no idea what the game actually is, but I don't think it really matters. If you like that kind of stuff, I'm sure you'll get a kick out of it. It'll be funny or something. Mm-hmm.
And Dishonored 2 looks good. I mean, it remains to be seen if it will be good or if it will be October style disappointment. Yeah. But I think hopefully it's good.
You can definitely see, if you've been keeping track of stuff for Dishonored 2, how much extra effort Bethesda is putting into the promotion of this game compared to everything else that they've done. It seems like
they want it to become a franchise.
I was just going to say the preview coverage has been insane. Like, they just keep showing more and more and more of the game. 15 minutes of play here, 15 minutes there, like just all over the place. It seems like they are already executing their no reviews, plenty of previews system.
You remind me of that now.
Yeah, sorry. For PS4 digital, we have Handball, which is also coming to PS3. And I love the box art because it's a dude just like screaming. And it's just like the last image I expected to see to associate with Handball. My name is Mayo.
Extremely intense sport, don't you know?
Apparently it's quite intense. I never thought of it in that way.
Children's playgrounds or anything.
Cute little innocent Handball. Just, it didn't occur to me. We also have My Name is Mayo, which I have no idea what that is, but it's also coming to Vita. I love the name, though. Maybe it's a sequel to I Am Bread.
Well, I hope it's not, basically.
Yeah, probably not, but I'm just taking a stab. And then Small Radios, Big Televisions. No punctuation in that, just Small Radios, Big Televisions.
Cool. In ellipsis.
Yeah. PS4 retail, we've got Marvel Pinball Epic Collection Volume 1. And that's it. That's what's coming out this week. Usually I feel like this is a bigger week, but I guess there are other things going on in the world, so we've got plenty to deal with.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I guess the three, well, the big hit is already released. The two big hits.
Yeah, I mean, the big stuff really is kind of already out. There's other stuff coming out this month, but I don't know that how much of it is actually of interest to us. I'll have to go back and look. But I think one of the biggest things coming out for the rest of the month is Pokemon. So.
Yes.
Yep, and then PS Plus, November, we'll run through real quick. PS4. Everybody's Gone to the Rapture, and the Deadly Tower of Monsters. PS3, Dirt 3, Costume Quest 2. Vita, you've got Letter Quest Remastered, and Pumped BMX Plus. And finally, to round out the show.
I was just looking at the Cartoon Network one. It's just like a sort of action beat-em-up one.
A shmup?
Yeah.
Not really a shmup, I guess. A b-mup.
Yeah. Something like that.
Everybody says that.
That's pretty bad. And then to round out the show, Ace, take it away with the trophies.
Ah, yes. My bit.
Finally my turn to shine.
Yes.
Yes. I still haven't managed to get to convince Brandon to give me a jingle. So you just had to imagine
the
top of the trophy pops. 50 most popular trophies this week. Well, I say this week. It's only been half a week since we last did a trophy chart, trademark, copyright, patent pending. Just kidding. but the Two Trophies podcast told you to get more variety, and I'm pleased to say you have. In the top 50 unlocks, there are 8 games this week from last time, 6. So good job, people. But I have some bad news for you, for you fantasy fans. Prince, World of Final Fantasy has dropped out of the top 50.
What are you doing?
Now, was that the final time we'll see it, or will it come back again? Up to you, TTers. So without further ado, the top 50 unlocks for the last week are from the following 8 games in reverse order. In number 8, down 6 places, Titanfall 2. Just clinging in there with The Graduate. 246 wins from 456 last week.
And that's just for finishing the tutorial, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, something like that. Yeah, and additional trophies, there's only 3 others in the top 50, whereas last week it was 16 other trophies. So I guess that means people are starting it, but not going very far with it. Maybe they've got distracted by another game that's come out.
Frenetic shooter. Yeah.
Mm. In at number 7, also down 2 places, there's an eerie silence from the Battlefield 1. play the objective.
I'm loving the cheese.
259 wins, down from 351, so a slight decrease there. And only 2 other trophies, down from 10. So again, people going very far with that one this week. But
right, so Titanfall 2 has taken a fall, but so has Battlefield.
Yeah. In at number 6, we have a new entry. Call of Duty Modern Warfare Remastered. Earn a Wing Dagger. 275 wins. Mm-hmm. Plus 1 other trophy that's just squeezed in there at the bottom. At place number 50.
Barely qualifying, really.
Hmm?
It's just about come in above these old entries.
Yeah.
Interestingly, Titanfall was higher up on the list.
Yeah. So I guess, not many people have jumped straight on that remaster, but who knows? Maybe it'll creep up.
Mm-hmm.
At number 5, down 4 places, is Skyrim. Bleak Falls Barrow. So will it continue to have a bleak fall in popularity? As there's only 6 other trophies, down from 10 from last time.
Mm-hmm.
In at number 4, a new entry. Everybody's Gone to the Rapture. So have TTers taken our advice from the last podcast and jumped on this one? Being a free PlayStation Plus game, you'd probably think so. Mm. 287 wins for Moonwalker. Plus 1 other trophy. So just, I guess, a lot of people dabbling, or like you say, diving on
that
one.
Funny thing about that one is the Moonwalker trophy is for walking backwards, obviously. But generally speaking, in that game, there is no starter trophy. So
yeah,
probably a lot more people than this have played it, just not popped a trophy yet.
Mm-hmm.
You think you can go through a long bit in that game without popping a trophy then?
Yeah, definitely.
Oh,
okay.
I think my original playthrough, I probably only had 2 or 3 trophies.
Ah, okay. Right, yeah. Where were we? Oh, yes. Up 3 places, at number 3 is LetterQuest Remastered, another PlayStation Plus game, showing off with 473 wins, plus 2 other trophies in the top 50.
Surprised to see it's high.
Interesting, yeah.
Ah, but the thing about that is there's a lot of wins there. It's far above any of the other entries below it, but there's only 2 extra trophies on that, so maybe people are really not getting very far in it. I don't know how the trophies in that game work. Maybe also you only get a few and that's it.
Yeah.
But it looks like people aren't getting very far in it.
Mm-hmm. Got distracted too quickly. At new in at number 2 is, of course, Call of Duty Infinite Warfare Rising Threat, 654 wins plus 19 other trophies in the top 50. So everyone's definitely on the Call of Duty Infinite Warfare.
Taking
a proper entry.
Yeah, taking Titanfall's old spot.
Yes, yeah. So what beat Call of Duty number 1 slot?
Can you guess?
You might be surprised. Yeah, up 2 places.
Well, this is a TT thing, I guess.
Up 2 places.
Up 2 places, yep, from last time. At number 1 is The Deadly Tower of Monsters. Were TTers intrigued by our podcast to check out the Deadly Tower of Monsters?
Seems
I
so.
I vaguely remember us saying something about it being entirely about skydiving and so on. So yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Plus, Dramatic Rescuer, 739 wins. Plus 8 other trophies. So a fairly good presence on the top 50.
Mm-hmm. Not as many trophies on the in the 50, but still the most for its first trophy.
Second highest, yeah, to Call of Duty. Yeah. Mm-hmm. There's another PlayStation Plus title, of course. Gives it a helping hand.
Not bad. That's 9 trophies, and the game only has 24, so...
Oh, I see. Yeah, that does put it in perspective.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, so that's the trophies for this week. And I think that's going to wrap it up for us. If you have anything to talk about, if you want to say hey, you can check us out on Twitter at TrueTrophies, at _BrandFoo. You can shoot us a PM on the site if you want. Say hey. And even if you play Xbox, obviously we do too. So if you want to play a couple of matches or something, hit us up, let us know. Thanks for joining us once again. And we will see you next week. Bye-bye for now.
See you around.
See ya.